I think the most important thing is obviously having a beautifully made product, but even with that, the market is so saturated. So the thing that stands out to me the most is when a designer has a really authentic story to their brand and when you can really see the passion to their story.
You are listening to Thrive by Design, business, marketing, and lifestyle strategies for your jewelry brand to flourish and thrive. Let's get started.
Welcome to the Thrive by Design podcast, episode 174. Hey there, it's Tracy Matthews, the Chief Visionary Officer over at Flourish and Thrive Academy and the host of the Thrive by Design podcast. And I am excited to be here today because, as usual, I have a great guest on our show. I love answering your questions. I love helping you guys out. And I love bringing on fun new guests with different angles. And, you know, one of the things that we hear behind the scenes at Flourish and Thrive, or maybe one of the things that I know you're thinking based on the questions you ask, is what does it mean when an editor is creating a story? Like, what are they thinking of? How do we get inside their brains? Well, you're lucky because today I have a very, very special guest. She is the editor of the New York Times T-Style magazine, and she covers fashion and accessories. And as the editor, she's editing her pages, looking out for new designers to feature, and conceptualizing stories to tell throughout the magazine. And so today, I'm excited to invite my guest, Angela Coe, on the show today. I met Angela at the Jewelry Independent Summit this summer, and I got to moderate a panel that she was on, which was really great because this panel was all about how to get featured in magazines and in the press. And they talked a little bit about behind the scenes and just different 360 aspects. And so I asked Angela back then to be on the show. She told me she couldn't do it until after New York Fashion Week was over, which was perfect because now we get to listen and learn about how she's picking trends, how she's spotting trends, how she's creating stories based on those trends and using it in like the fashion, or combining fashion and jewelry, maybe is the best way to put it. And then she also talks about how they're featuring product and the balance of, you know, how much product that's featured is actually from advertisers and how much product that's featured is actually from editorial content. So this is a really, really great episode. So if you're ever wondering how to get into the New York Times T-Style magazine, you're definitely going to want to listen up. And I think that what you're going to learn today and discover is not only some of the awesome trends that are happening for spring 2019, but some fun ways that you can maybe reach out and think outside of the box to get an editor's attention. Plus, at the end, we're going to share with you how you can reach out to Angela and say hello to her and like pitch her in the DMs, because the DMs are a great way to connect with editors of all types if you do it the right way. And so this is going to be a fun episode. So before we dive in, I would love to take a word from our sponsor today. Today's sponsor is FindingBox.com. I love brands that support small business because we're all small businesses here. And sometimes, you know, you don't want to order thousands and thousands of hang tags or logo design elements to add to your jewelry because it's expensive and you don't want to have to carry all that inventory, right? So FindingBox is a great solution for this because they have custom engraved logo hang tags, beads, and custom jewelry pouches. They love working with small business. In fact, they've worked with over 2,000 already. They have fast lead times. Some products can even be finished in 24 hours. Hello, thank you. They also only require you to place small order minimums, and you can get free design revisions, and they also provide a sample. So they're just really a great resource. We highly recommend that you go check them out and place your first order right now by using the code FNTPODCAST. That's FTPODCAST in all caps, and enjoy 10% off by January 31st, 2019. This is a great opportunity for you to save some money and also test out a new vendor where you can get small quantities and not have to be stuck with a ton of different things. Okay, let's jump right in to my interview with Angela Coe. I'm excited today. Well, I'm always excited today to be on Thrive by Design, but I'm especially excited because I have an amazing guest. I have Angela Coe here, who is the style editor of the New York Times style section. Angela, welcome to the show today.
Hi, thank you so much for having me.
It's awesome to have you here. So I was just so excited because I got to moderate a panel at the Jewelry Independent Summit, and you were one of the people that I was moderating questions to. Mm-hmm. And I loved all the things that you had to say. And we just came off Fashion Week here, and I just had to interview you to talk a little bit more about what trends you're seeing in the market and to sort of share with the designers who listen to the show a little bit more about what the prestigious New York Times style section actually, like what you're actually looking for in that section feature for designers. So first and foremost, it's awesome to have you here. So thank you. But more than anything, I'd love to hear a little bit more about your journey into the fashion world and like a little bit more about you.
Yeah. So I've been at the New York Times Style Magazine, which we can also call T Magazine. I've been at T Magazine for about 5 years now. And I started out as the fashion assistant, and I just worked my way up to now be the fashion market editor. Before that, my first job was at Elle Magazine, where I was the accessories assistant. And there, you know, I think my favorite part of that job was I had to take care of all the fine jewelry and jewelry coming in and out of the closet. And that's when I, you know, first started to see all these creative jewelry brands out there. Because I feel like when you're, if you're not in jewelry, you don't really know. But yeah, so that's, and then that was, yes, yeah, so Elle was my first job. And before that, I was interning at a ton of places. You know, I did internships at Harper's Bazaar, at W. I kind of got a taste of all the magazines. And yeah, that's how I kind of ended up here at the New York Times Style Magazine.
That's so fun. Well, in the pre-show, we were just chit-chatting and you're sitting in the closet right now to record this interview.
Yeah, I am.
Which is so funny because I'm sitting in my closet. My audience knows that I record my podcast in my closet. So we're both sitting in the closet, which is...
We are. I mean, and we share the floor with the actual New York Times. So it's so funny when a lot of desk sides come to me and our meeting rooms are like glass walls, mm-hmm. and these reporters just walk by just so confused, like, what is this tray of like diamonds doing in this office? So funny. So, but this closet, it's closed off, so no one can bother me.
I love it. So when you're doing those desk side with the glass, you know, the glass windows, do they stop by and say like do you like spontaneous trunk shows happen?
Yeah, this we get a lot of, is this like a sample sale happening? We get a lot of that question. If we have like a big shoot, people like kind of slow down and try to snoop. But I get it. If you're not in it, I'm sure it's so fascinating to see racks and racks of clothes and shoes and jewelry just all in one place.
That's so funny. I love that. I remember when I was just starting out doing desk sides at different publications and going in, and some of them actually asked me to come back and do trunk shows in their office for the publicity side of the magazine. So it wasn't necessarily for the editors, but it was for the ad side. They would be like, come in, we want to like shop your collection for holiday and stuff.
Oh,
like
that's super fun. That's so cool. That's a great idea, actually.
I know, right?
Yeah, write that down. Yeah.
Get brands to come in so everyone can do their holiday shopping. Uh-huh. It's perfect. Uh-huh. So when you're for T Magazine, you know, obviously you're probably like bombarded all the time with people like reaching out to you and all that stuff. So what is it that you're really looking for in brands to cover in the magazine? How do you find most of the brands?
I think the most important thing, first and foremost, is obviously having a beautifully made product. But even with that, the market is so saturated. So I think the thing that stands out to me the most is when a designer has a really authentic story to their brand and when you can really see the passion to their story. And I've been doing this for years and I have come across people who are just in it for the wrong reasons, or they're in it for the money, or they're, you know, what that you can. It really does reflect on the product. So I think if you're a designer out there and you know you're in it for the right reasons, you know you love your product, then I'm sure somehow that's going to be, you know, portrayed in your jewelry or clothing or whatever it is you're making. And how I find most of my brands is kind of a mixture of a lot of things. I think the most traditional ways have tons of relationships with different publicists. And usually they grow throughout the years and they are the ones that come to me with new brands they have, and they pitch me story ideas and new brands that come their way. Another way is word of mouth, which is, you know, through friends of friends introducing me to a brand, which I find to be quite effective because you kind of have a personal relationship with this person. So you have more of a personal connection with this brand that's being introduced to you. I mean, these are all ways of people coming to me, but I also go out there and I try to hunt for brands. And that, I think Instagram is so helpful with that. It's just, it's so easy to click on, you know, a really great jewelry reporter or blogger and just going down a rabbit hole and just clicking the next, you know, designer that's tagged. Mm-hmm. And that's a really easy way for me to find new jewelry designers. It's actually more easier with jewelry than ready to wear, I think, with looking Instagram. For brands on Instagram. Yeah. Especially because I think most ready to wear designers work off of a retail calendar, but jewelry designers, if they make something new, they just post it right away. So it's a lot of newness all the time. And then another way I find designers is if I, you know, the stores that I regularly shop at, like Dover Street or like Totokayo, like interesting, mm-hmm. unique stores, I try to always see who they're carrying and who their new designers are.
Oh, awesome. That's great. So you get through stores, through word of mouth, through publicist, through...
Yeah, so it's a mixture
Instagram.
Of everything. Yeah.
Do you ever
take exactly.
pitches from people that you've never heard of before?
To be honest, it is rare. I think, especially if you're in editorial for a long time, you kind of do know everyone that's publicist-wise. You kind of do know everyone mm-hmm. credible out there. So I am more hesitant. If someone I've never heard of shot me an email, if I'm busy, you know, it'd probably be in my to-do list. And I might not get back to it for even months. But I'm not saying it's impossible, though. I think if the images in the email catch my eye right away, then yeah, I would. And this happened before. I've had designers who just found my email and emailed me and had a beautiful lookbook, and I responded, you know, that week and wanting to know more. So it is tougher if you don't have a connection with the editor, but it's not impossible. So if that's the only way, I would say just give it a shot, because you never know.
You never know. Yeah. And then you might find this amazing brand that you'd never heard of before.
Yeah.
And you're excited to feature them. Okay. So we just got a fashion week. And I'm dying to hear what you saw out there and what's the coolest stuff.
Yeah.
So what's happening for 2018 and for spring 2018 as far as jewelry trends and fashion goes?
And fashion always repeats itself. So it's so, because I've been coming up with fashion stories at Tea for 3 or 4 years now. And it's so funny because it's really the same trends, but we just have to repackage it. And with that said, I really think fashion is, you know, it's always a reflection of what's happening in the world today, you know, such as when the Burberry trench was invented, that was during World War II for soldiers. So I think right now the most powerful thing that's happening is, you know, since the election, is people protesting and women just standing up for their rights. And I think that is trickling upwards to the runway, because I feel like the biggest trends were kind of a lot of suiting, beautiful suiting, like in Balenciaga, Tom Ford, Givenchy, they all kind of, you know, gave a nod to the 80s with
the power suit. Beautiful,
the power suit, yeah, exactly. The power suit for, you know, and I feel like that's in the 80s is when women were really starting to go into the office and try to get office jobs. And so you can kind of see that fashion influence from the 80s of power suiting coming back onto the runway. Another big influence, I would say, is it was a ballerina dance influence. And if you watch the Dior show, they had actual beautiful dancers performing while the models were walking. Mm. And it was so beautiful. But in a way, it's kind of it goes back to women empowerment, because I feel like dance is such an empowering sport and it's such a beautiful way to express oneself. And so, you know, on there's a lot of beautiful beiges and nudes and blush tones in flowy skirts and wrap dresses and a lot of ballet flats, not just at Dior, but Stella McCartney had it, and Burberry had a lot of dance influence as well. For jewelry, there's a few people that are my favorite runway jewelry trend starters. One used to be Celine, but it's changed a lot this season with the new creative director. So I went to Balenciaga, which is one of my favorite designers, and he always does interesting costume jewelry that's fun to wear. And this season he did, again, some 80s influence in my eyes. He did a lot of sculptural gold and silver chains and statement earrings And he did a big button earring with a zebra print on it, which is a bit 80s as well.
The buttons are back. Oh my gosh.
The buttons are back. Yeah. And I think brands like Marnie, who does always a strong costume jewelry, they also have oversized gold chains and statement necklaces and statement earrings and big gold sculptural shapes. So, you know, that kind of fit well with the whole 80s trend again. And then kind of off from that, I think another jewelry trend I saw was this wanderlust, bohemian, these beautiful, like almost homemade pieces. Like I think it was Chloe had this like beaded cuff that was so beautiful. And then they did like anklets and toe rings. I haven't seen toe rings in a while, but it just gave it a kind of like a wanderlust boho just feeling to the show. And Luebe had some handcrafty looking pieces too, jewelry wise.
That's awesome.
So I guess, yeah.
So I said spring 2018, but I really meant spring 2019.
Yeah. I always get so confused too, because, you know, I'm working on Resort. I'm watching the spring 2019, but, you know, right now fall is in stores. I always get confused with the seasons.
I know, it's hard. I can't even believe that it's already the end of the year, which is like so crazy to me, which is,
yeah.
So I'm glad that you said suits are in, because I just wore like our insurance sponsor at our live event called me the business mermaid, because I wore a Veronica Beard suit that was like sparkly and iridescent, but also
awesome.
Power suit colors.
Oh, I love it.
Which was so fun. So what are some of the brands that you're absolutely loving at the moment, besides the ones that you mentioned, the bigger ones?
Yeah.
Are there any independent brands that you love?
Yeah, there's so many. And I feel like people like the CFDA and LVMH are really doing a great job cultivating these brands. In New York, I would say my favorite young designer his name is Matthew Adams Dolan. And he's been around for a while and he is in the CFDA this year. So I'm very happy for him
That's
for awesome. That. And then there's Richard Quinn, who's a young designer in London, but he's most famous for last season, the Queen showed up to his show, which is
Oh my gosh.
Unreal. That's probably the most famous person that's ever been to any show. But I think the British Council who's running the Fashion Week, I think they really wanted, you know, more support for these young designers. So they got her to go to the show, which is incredible.
He must have been like freaking out.
Oh my God. I don't even know what I would do if But yeah, I think there's a lot of great young designers both designers, they're you know, not afraid to take risks. Their clothes are interesting and original. Because, you know, on the other side, there are designers out there that are just knocking off people, or, you know, they're just in it for the money. And out of all that, you know, I'm glad there are still young, creative people who want to make their own designs and that are like, and these people, I'm friends with Matthew Adams Dolan, and the amount of hustle he had to go through, you know, just trying to stay afloat.
Yeah.
And finally getting that recognition. It's definitely worth it.
It's like, I feel like building an independent brand, whether it's jewelry or fashion or anything else, it really requires this like tremendous amount of courage to continue to put yourself out there and
I'm sure
hustle and just like really going for it to build a business.
Yeah.
Because at the end of the day, like I don't really believe in competition because I think you can stand out from the crowd. But at the end of the day, like there are a lot of other options, maybe is the best way to put it. Mm-hmm. It's how you position yourself is what really matters.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly.
Longevity is really determined by your ability to continue to move forward.
Yeah.
And come up with good ideas, right?
Yeah, 100%. Yes.
Awesome. Okay, so you're curating stories all the time. You said you're working on Resort right now as we speak. Like, how do you come up with the ideas for the stories that you make?
Generally, I just watch I watch all of the Resort 2019 shows. And then it's kind of like you just make I literally just have folders on my desktop. And I mean, to simplify, it could be like floral and utilitarian. And you just start putting looks into these folders. And then, I mean, and the story kind of grows and you kind of see what the biggest trends are. And like I said, trends always repeat itself. So it could be floral, but then I would have to find a way to spin it to maybe it's going to be like floral dresses with a punk twist or for this season. So generally I come up with the stories off of just the runway shows. But there are, you know, sometimes, and I recently had to do this, where it's kind of like the end of the year and there's a list, and I shouldn't be saying this, but there's like a list of advertisers that we haven't shot, and it's kind of just like, we have to make up a story with these people in it. And so there's sometimes that's how a story can appear as well.
Okay, that's cool. And how do you like decide to pick jewelry in these stories when you're featuring like, like, let's say you're doing like punk floral dresses and themes. Like, what's your decision process for selecting jewelry to work into that story?
So when it comes to fashion shoots, we have like a handful of fashion stylists that we hire. And since the story is more about fashion, we kind of have a conversation with them asking if they need any accessories to accessorize it. So it's more up to them. But I do the same thing, but with just only jewelry stories. And that, I mean, jewelry doesn't really have a fashion week, but they do have like couture, and they do have kind of like marks of the beginning of their season. So in the same way, I kind of try to get my eyes on everything out there. And then I come up with these folders, and then I come up with trends, which evolve into bigger story ideas. And for that, it's also kind of the same as fashion. We do have to shoot a lot of our advertisers. So as long as they're in it, that's, you know, the other spots, we have room to play with anyone interesting that's up and coming that we want to include.
Oh, I love it. So do you go to a lot of the shows?
For jewelry, I go to the couture show in Vegas. Mm-hmm. And then there's one in Paris that our director goes to. So
premier class or something else?
It's, I think it's just called couture.
Couture of Paris. Okay.
Go. Yeah. It happens during actual, like, they're ready to wear couture. And then a lot of jewelry designers show out there. And then we have a men's team that goes to Basel.
Awesome.
And so we kind of, you know, we kind of split and conquer. And then we come back with the photos that we have and come up with these stories.
Oh, that's so fun. Do you love it?
I do. It's I can't complain. I think every editor you meet probably loves to complain how tired they are. But at the end of the day, it's a fun job. And I think the best part is honestly being able to support these young designers and making beautiful images with them.
That's so cool. Well, I remember I just like called to mind. I remember when we were talking at Jewelry Independent, you were talking about how you're known for your sneakers. You must wear a lot of sneakers.
Oh, yeah.
Down. It's so funny.
I was just saying, you have to. I feel like the days of editors wearing heels are over, because you really got to hustle on both sides.
You know, the cool thing is that there are so many cool sneakers out there right now.
Yeah, that is true.
I just bought this really awesome pair of animal print sneakers from a brand called Greats, which is in
Oh, Berlin. Yeah.
And they're super fun. I did a photo shoot. This is totally off topic, but I did this photo shoot and the photographer posted a picture of me wearing the sneakers, and no one said anything about anything else.
But they wanted the sneakers. That's great.
I know. Funny. I have just like one final question for you. What's the most interesting pitch that you've ever gotten, and why did it stand out?
Oh my gosh. I get so many. It's hard to say. It's an obvious answer, but it really is people who think outside of the box. I think the last really memorable one, it happened to my coworker who sits next to me, and she covers beauty. And I think as editors, like every day we get all these press kits, we get so much crap sent to our office. And this brand just sent a letter and being like, we're promoting XYZ. And, you know, we're like an eco-conscious brand. And because of that, we would like to like clear out all your junk. Like they provided a service where we could just donate all this junk that we got from in the office and at home. And that really, I mean, that's these people, you could just tell that they did their homework, and it's authentic, because instead of sending us a crap load of things, they, you know, did the opposite and offered to clean our junk bin. So I thought that was really clever.
They're in alignment with that eco-friendly mission that they had. I remember speaking to a buyer once, and she's like, don't send me a bunch of like packaging in a huge box with like a postcard in it, because it drives me crazy, because we are a brand that's in alignment with, you know, sustainability and being friendly, and that's just like a waste of stuff.
Yeah, exactly. So for them, it really worked. And, you know, there's other, I think, publicists that I'm close with. You really get to know the editor and they figure out what you like. You know, sometimes they're like, let's go to this workout class because they know I like to go to the gym. And then that's a way to, you know, talk about a brand. So I think when you first pitch to someone, I'm sure like if you're a creative designer, you'll find a creative way to pitch, but you'll start to, you know, have these relationships with editors and as they start to grow, I'm sure you'll find a way to pitch them that tailors to them.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for being here today. This was awesome.
Thank you so much for having me.
Oh, it's my pleasure. What's the best way for people to connect with Tea Magazine and with you?
They can go to my Instagram. It's ang.koh. I usually don't respond to my DMs, but I actually, after the Jewelry Independent Summit, I've started to because I realized that is a really great way for designers to reach out to me. So if they just slide into my DMs, I will, you know, get back to them as soon as possible.
Slide into your DMs. Okay, awesome. And we'll have a link for your Instagram on the show notes as well. And make sure that you follow Tea Magazine, guys. We'll also have a link to the show notes as well. Angela, thank you so much for being here today. It's been so awesome.
Yeah, thank you so much for having me.
I want to thank my guest again, Angela Koh, for joining me today. Make sure that you guys check her out. Go follow her on Instagram. And if you feel like you have an innovative pitch or a story to reach out to her, make sure that you develop a relationship with her first, comment on her posts, start a conversation, and reach out to her with an incredible story idea. And hopefully you too will get featured. And if not, you know, keep putting yourself out there because that is what it's all about. Taking that leap of faith and getting the exposure for your brand so that you can continue to grow consistent sales. So we're going to have all of Angela's information over on the show notes. She also mentioned it here. So if you're on your phone, you could just pop on over to Instagram and search for her. And if you're trying to get more exposure for your brand, I'd love for you to think about your current outreach strategy and what you're doing to actually get exposure and traffic to your business. And it all starts with your website as your number one sales tool. So if you are struggling to get, you know, exposure for your brand or consistent sales, or you've gotten to a certain point and you're really trying to get to that six or multiple six figure mark in your jewelry business, I would highly encourage you, and you're stuck because you don't know what is missing, I'd highly encourage you for you to jump on a game plan call with me or someone on my team. And here's how you can do that. You can head on over to flourishthriveacademy.com/game-plan-call. And from there, you can find out exactly how you can apply to get on one of these calls. We don't give them away to everyone. You have to qualify for a certain criteria, but I definitely recommend that you do this because at the end of it, we're going to show you exactly what you need to do and what the next steps are for you to kind of reach your goals and reach your dreams. So head on over to flourishthriveacademy.com/game-plan-call. Check out the parameters and let's do this because my mission here this year and over the next period of time is really to help designers not only reach their goal, but to get to a place where they're paying themselves an amazing salary. And for independent jewelry brands, what we've figured out is that if you're doing about $100,000 or slightly more in revenue, that you're taking home a $50,000 paycheck. And for most people, depending on where you live in the United States, that is a living wage. And we're trying to inspire entrepreneurship for men and women who want something better for themselves, who want to use their creativity to grow their business, who want to use their creativity to actually build something that's in alignment with their passion and continue to grow. So if that sounds like something that you want to do and you're ready to go for it and you're full out, and or you have a business that's already doing maybe six figures or a little bit more and you're trying to get to your next level, whatever that looks like, I'd highly encourage you to jump on one of these calls so that you can talk to someone on my team and we can help you map out the next steps for your next level of success. So head on over to flourishthriveacademy.com/game-plan-call and let's do this, shall we? Thanks for listening today. And if you haven't done so already, I would love for you to rate and review the show. Head on over to iTunes or wherever podcasts are listened to. Give us a little rating, give us a little review, and tell us what you think because this helps us curate the most amazing content moving forward. Thank you so much for listening today. This is Tracy Matthews signing off. Until next time.